Iyengar, followed by an introduction about the session, and then I would request Professor Iyengar to take us through the session. Professor R.N. Iyengar is renowned for his contribution to earthquake engineering, structural dynamics, and mathematical modeling. After a long and distinguished academic career as chair professor at the Indian Institute of Sciences and director, Central Building Research Institute of CSIR, he is currently the director, Center for Ancient History and Culture at Jain University, Bengaluru. With a good background in Sanskrit, he combines Indian knowledge systems with modern analytical methods. His findings on comets, eclipses, earthquakes, precession, and the pole star Dhruva in Vedic literature have attracted worldwide attention. He has brought out two ancient Sanskrit treatises, the Parashara Tantra on natural sciences, and the Narada Shilpa Shastra on architectural civil engineering, with critical introductions, translations, and notes. Presently, he is editing the Vridhagargiya, I'm sorry, sir, for my pronunciations, Vridhagargiya Jyotisha, another ancient text on Indian astral sciences. About the session, Architectural Engineering Heritage of India. India has engineering marvels like palaces, temples, bridges, dams, irrigation structures spread across the width and breadth of the country. The Bronze Age towns of Dholavira and Lothal, the bamboo bridges of Northeast India, the step wells of Gujarat, the jewel box like Hoysala architecture, the palm leaf drawings, and the project site dairy of the Konark Temple are all equally awe-inspiring. One can easily get mesmerized by the monumental iconic structures made of bricks, stones, terracotta, wood, metal, and some sculpted outer fills. The formidable Indian knowledge systems of Shilpa and Vastu are not only enshrined in large number of Sanskrit texts, but also are realized in the field. They also provide a sophisticated and civilizational dimension to India that has to be taught and nurtured in our institutions. Welcome, Professor Iyengarji. We are really honored to have you with us. Please take us through your
knowledge. Richardji, I would also, Professor Iyengar, this is Anuradha here. I just wanted to offer Anuradha from IIT Kharagpur.
Yeah.
From okay. Jain University.
Yeah, I know.
Yes. No, just wanted to offer my pranams and warm welcome as well for the program. Wonderful to see you again. Thank you.
Thank you. So let me first thank the organizers for inviting me to this interesting FDP program, a very ambitious program. It's a panoramic view of Indian history and culture which is being promoted in these 2 weeks. And I'm happy to join you with, in a very small way, on something which I have been interested as a civil engineer all through my life and wondering why some of the interesting things in our country are not taught in the courses to our students. Well, anyway, let me quickly go through my talk. If at all we have to introduce this topic, it will be in terms of Vastu and Shilpa. Many of you would have heard these words, but you know, technically they mean quite different. Popularly, you know, newspapers and TVs, you would see about Vastu advisors and things of that kind. But actually, as an IKS, they have very special meanings. Shilpa is actually the artistic creation. Is a replication of nature. And in fact, Shilpa is a Vedic word. The Veda itself, the word Shilpa comes up. So all kinds of art, you can say music, dance, painting, they are all included in Shilpa. It is something which is creative, which is a replication of nature, of actually divine concepts by the humans. But how do the humans do? They need a material, that is the Vastu. And that Vastu becomes the Vastu later on. So the Vastu that is available is the medium, you know, the Prithvi, Ap, Tejas, Vayu, and Akasha. These are the five material available to anyone. Now, this is about how to use prithvi, ap, vayu, akasha to replicate nature, to replicate the divine concepts is about architectural engineering, to put it concisely. But how that is done over thousands of years and how the theory and practice has been going on in this country, at least till the pre-modern period. Not in the modern period. I will not be covering the modern period or the colonial period. And I'm not going to talk about history, but it is only to give you an idea of what has been there and what can be introduced to some extent in our curriculum. Now, Vastu and Shilpa are the two faces of the same discipline. Now, when we talk of engineering, particularly this is going to be about civil engineering, as we know that today, in contrast with other types of engineering, it involves reconnaissance, site selection, roads, bridges, water resources, building materials, a variety of things. And architecture is going to be about planning, how to divide space. These are some of the modern definitions also, and about elevation, dimensioning, aesthetics, proportioning, decoration, carpentry, sculpting, variety of things. All this went in ancient India also, hand in hand, as envisaged by the divine architect Vishwakarma. That is going to be the starting point. See, today when we teach civil engineering, we talk about Greeks, Romans. That is how something, at least some textbooks start. But here we will have to start in a different way. And the Indian knowledge system is traditionally known as Sthapatya Veda. Veda is only knowledge. This is called the Sthapatya Veda. Now, a few further things without getting into too many details. Is architecture different from civil engineering? That question comes up to many of us. As a civil engineer, I have been questioned. I have asked this question to many of my colleagues also. As a colonial legacy, architecture is different, civil engineering is different, as you know very well. The architectural councils are different, engineering council is different, the faculties are different, the teaching people are different, the subjects are different. The professions also, they claim that they are different professions altogether. Traditional view was not that. Architecture and civil engineering are the two faces of the same coin. One is the theory, the other is the practice. Like you would say Lakshana and Lakshya. You have musicology as Lakshana. Lakshya is going to be music. As recently, just a few minutes back, we heard the beautiful sitar recital. Now the theory behind it is going to be the Lakshana, so to say. Now Shilpa and Vastu are like form and content. Now project planning and field work. Project planning could be said about the ideation and creativity, that is like architecture. The field work is actual construction, making that come into a three-dimensional body. This is how, if you see the ancient literature, our heritage has progressed. Now, all this, of course, you can extend it in various other ways also. And the heritage of civil engineering can be appreciated if we keep in our mind the idealistic interplay between art and civic construction. So civil engineering, if you have to give a definition, it is going to be between an art, that is an imagination, a creativity, a forum, something about aesthetics. But eventually that has to come into the civic field that is available to the common man in the society as a three-dimensional body is going to be civil engineering. This could be a bridge, this could be a road, this could be a well, this could be a water resource, or it can be even a house. So from the idealistic ancient perspective, so civil engineering, if I have to define today, is going to be to reproduce on human societal scale the naturally existing balance among the five basic elements, which you know already, the five ones. The first two refer to earth and water. That is going to be about the material, the vastu. The other two, that is the tejas and vayu, is about lighting and ventilation. Very important point. The third is an esoteric concept where the plans have to be made using square patterns on earth. that has something to do with the Vedic view of the cosmos and the sun's movement and something to follow the sun's shadow on earth. Can't go into the philosophical details of that. That is what is called the Vastu Mandala. So the division of space has to follow some principles. Now, for example, the central part is left open to the sky called the Brahmasthana. Those principles are followed very systematically in ancient practices. But today, of course, in our modern buildings, not everybody follows that. That's a different matter. Now, if you see, how did the construction concept come up? The Purana says something. The Brahmanda Purana says, all this started by human beings observing very intelligently how trees balance themselves. So the Sanskrit shloka I have given here, Budhya Anvishya Yatha Nyayam Vriksha Shaka Gata Yatha. How the trees give their branches and they balance themselves on ground in a similar way, the houses have to be constructed and the roof has to be constructed so that they are all balanced. And the shaka is a branch and that itself is called shala. Shaka and shala have the same meaning in ancient Sanskrit. And this is all concerning the Vedic shala actually. Shala, as all of us know, it is a hall. And even in modern times, you know, shala and sala are same. And this hall was supported by trees. The Vedic shala was also supported by the Udumbura tree. Like the columns were taken, the four columns and the center beam and all that. So, and important thing here is Buddhya Anvishya. You have to use your brain to see nature and understand it properly. And this is how the whole of engineering concept or Shilpa concept in India has grown, is the contention of the Brahmanda Purana, one of the oldest among our Puranas. And this also says all our concepts of architecture and engineering, be of a temple, be of a palace, or even of a bridge, later on we would see, they have all come from trees. So from carpentry, you can say, or from timber, you can say. So timber has been the main thing, and how timber can be bent in various ways, the later architectural forums have also, more or less, if you compare, then they would look like a basket, they would look like a net. They are all very beautiful things, but that is produced not in timber, not in cane, but in stone or in metal or in brick or in other kinds of materials. That is where that Buddhya Anvishya, you have to use your intelligence and then reproduce it as possible. So Indian knowledge system historically can be taken as anything starting from the, if you talk about history, from the Indus Saraswati civilization, we have to take it to the pre-modern period, say about 1850. Now, I will not be talking about the history, as I said, but I will just go through a few synoptics or pictures and photographs, and I will talk with a reference to them. All branches of engineering were practiced in the Harappan cities way back around 3000 BC. We know this. We don't need a book for this because we can go there and visually see these things. What are they? The town planning, roads, water supply, sanitation, residences, metal castings, which can all be visualized. This is the aerial view of the Mohenjo-Daro city. And you can see the kind of rectangle and square divisions, and we do not know whether these formed the basis for our Vastu text, which came up later on, because our texts are available in fixed form only from about 500 BC. I will come to that. Whereas these cities are at least 2000 years older than that. But anyway, the form seems to be very similar. And this is the kind of division of the residential house in Mohenjo-Daro for various purposes. And if you see Vishwakarma Prakasha or even the Narada Shilpa, which I am going to say a few words later on, there are going to be units available in an interior division of a house for various purposes, for a reception room, a dining hall, a bedroom, a meeting hall, things of that kind. And if you take on the aspect of the engineering issues, because the two you have to consider together, you would see that one of the very important things that we observe in the Harappan period is about water management. Now, earth and water always have gone together in our country. In the last, if I want to see a general perspective of this. And you would see here, this is a well, and the bricks are not rectangular perfectly. They look like trapezoidal. So the shape is slightly different. And right today, unless you order, people would say, okay, the bricks are going to be rectangular bricks of a particular size, either in South India or in North India. But in the ancient period, they were ordering bricks of various shapes. You will see that later on when you come to the altar of a Vedic altar, a large Vedic altar, where even triangular bricks, semicircular bricks had to be ordered and prepared. Now, this is actually what I'm showing here is a corbelled culvert for drainage. These kind of drainage patterns where there is a large channel with a small channel here is very standard. Even today, this is the kind of system which is used in all civic purposes. You will see a large one which will take away during the rainy season the water, whereas at other time, there will be, the flow will be very small. So a small depression, this kind of small channel is sufficient. This is the standard way, and this has been there for the last nearly 5,000 years. And archaeologists have studied this in very great detail, because engineering, let me say architecture engineering, is not just about temples, it's not just about palaces, it's not just about a few arches and putting up some decorative images here and there, making a flower image or so. It has to concern everything from birth up to the last minute of human beings. And the important thing is about disposal of public waste, which in fact we are struggling today so much in all over India. And the water supply and sewage disposal in Mohenjo-daro, that is in Harappan cities, has been of international importance. This is from World Archaeology. I'm reproducing on archaeology of public health. How the people were healthy in those days? What was the kind of sanitation they had? That was the question. Because you know, this civilization survived nearly 2,000 to 2,500 years wonderfully in ancient time. I will not read this, but what he says is, it is one of the wonderful kind of construction which is still standing. Some of the canals, some of the wells, some of the water tanks, which one can go and see what was the kind of mortar which was used, what was the kind of brick which was used, whether how they controlled the temperature in these things. And each house had its own bathing and toilet facilities, which in fact, if you are interested, one can go to Dholavira, which is very near Ahmedabad, and see for oneself. And when I went there, I was amazed how the houses and the bathing rooms were there. Very similar to some we can see in our villages even to this day. Each house will have in a small corner, but the water is taken out into a drainage and which goes by the side of the road and taken out of the city. So this person, Johnson, who's an authority on public health, says an astonishing feat of civil engineering achieved by this culture over 4,000 years ago is the network of effluent drains built of brick masonry along the streets of Mohenjo-daro. He has looked into Mohenjo-daro, but you can see even Dholavira, Lothal, they all have the same thing. The drains mostly ran along past houses on one side, an unpaved U-shape in cross-section, were built of bricks, and the covers, whether loose bricks or so, they can be opened for cleaning. The width of the open top, the inner urban water supply and effluent disposal systems stand out as major achievements of mature Harappans. Here, for the first time in the history of mankind, such waterworks were developed to a perfection which was to remain unsurpassed until the coming of the Romans and the flowering of civil engineering and architecture in classical antiquity more than 2000 years later. See, we are taught, I was taught like that the Roman arches, they were the first ones about 2000 years ago, the Romans started civil engineering. But when later in my life, when I studied all this, I find that people accepted 2000 years before Romans started all this practice, it was already prevalent in the Indian subcontinent. Now, why this civilization collapsed? It would be a question that all civil engineers are going to ask, no doubt. Because it is not sufficient if we construct, but we'll have to protect them also. This is the Bronze Age up to about 2500 BC. There are so many reasons which are given. Some people say it is because of the drying of Saraswati River. But why did Saraswati River dry up? Maybe because there was catastrophes, there were earthquakes, maybe there were floodings, maybe there were comet impacts, meteoritic impacts, we don't know. But in any case, this happened, and this all, we know that the northwest of India, including Gujarat and Rajasthan, is prone for earthquake damage. So severe loss of habitat can cause discontinuity in cultural practices. This we have to bear in our mind. We have had a serious cultural discontinuity around 1500 BC. Later on, there may not have been minor discontinuities. And this happens mainly due to natural disasters. Now, this is the picture of Dholavira, what I am showing here. And this is the geographical position of Bhuj and the Khadir Island, which is actually not in a sea. Right now it looks all green, but this is actually the run of Kutch. It's a dried up sea. Can't go into the details, but you would see this diagram shows in those days, it was all a sea and there were boats which could be going. And these boats, from Lothal to Dholavira, they were communicating through some channel here, which of course nowadays is not visible. Maybe underneath Ahmedabad and present day Baroda, these channels were going, we do not know. So important thing is the earth has to be used intelligently in a way that our construction, that is the engineering or the architectural things, can be standing as monumental structures. Whatever monumental structures which were there in those period, in those days, can't see them. But the town itself is a monument. Dholavira itself is a monument. This is a reconstructed figure, but the town would have looked something like this with two rivers coming in, supplying water for this, which is a forted city. Some of you are interested, they can go and see that. I'm telling this, as an earthquake engineer, because I have spent a lot of time with earthquakes, ancient people have referred to earthquakes, the natural disasters, and there is one of the very important information if we have to maintain our knowledge systems properly. Starting from the Vedas, the natural sciences have been there. And that is the natural sciences book, the Parashar Tantra, which I mentioned, which has a chapter on comets, which is a chapter on earthquakes, which is a full chapter on rainfall, rainfall including measurement. And these supporting systems, supporting knowledge systems are equally important in for a civilization like our civilization. Now, if you leave aside the 1500 BC period, we come to the Mauryan period, or you can say the Magadhan kingdom, starting roughly with what the Puranas call the Navanandas. So the cities once again started from Pataliputra, as we know, and slowly the urban civilization started with a break of about 1,000 years or slightly more than that. During that period, what we can see, huge structures, apart from some of the stupas, the Buddhist stupas, one of which I will show later, there has been a Vedic altar. This is a Vedic altar built out of burnt bricks. This is in Himalayas, in Purala. This belongs to 1st century BC. The Shunga kings conducted what is called a Shayana Yaga here. While I was at Roorkee, I went to this place and took this photograph and tested some of the bricks also. Wonderful bricks, burnt bricks. They're still strong. And this is a huge structure. And because they have to get the shape of a bird, there are different kind of altars which are done. If you want to get a shape like this for the altar, you need triangular bricks, square bricks, rectangle bricks, even semicircular bricks. They ordered all of them. They counted how many you need and ordered them. And those evidences, not only here on ground, but in the books, they are available. In the Shulba Sutras, they are available. And it has gone to such an extent in the Vedic period, roughly belonging these books to about people say 600 BC or 800 BC, including the famous Bodhayana theorem nowadays, which is coming up even in the newspapers, the so-called Pythagorean relationship of the right angle triangle. Without that, they could not have done these things. They give all the right angle triplets, many of them, at least 16 right angle triplets are listed in the Shulba Sutra books so that they can get the bricks of that particular size. And you would see that, I will just read one of the sutras which is there. The decrease in shapes suffered by the bricks due to drying and burning is made good by further addition so as to restore the original shape. The original shape of the bird or a corner or a bend, whatever it is, that has to be restored. So they knew that, and the decrease is always by 1/30th part of the original, the shrinking. Hence, the same is to be added to have the original shape. So if you want about 12 angula, they would increase it, the original thing, so that after burning, it will come to 12 angula. This is a kind of precision they were adopting, and that led to very high, what you can say, sophisticated mathematics, geometry, and number theories. We'll not go into that. It might already been covered. Then when you come to about the famous period of the Mauryas, it is the Kautilya's Arthashastra, which becomes a very good reference. Apart from the governance and the statecraft, for which it is very deservingly famous worldwide, it gives rainfall measurement. It says how rainfall should be measured, how rainfall should be reported to the Adhikari every year, and how much rainfall normally you can expect in the kingdom, in Avanti, in Pataliputra, and in other regions. And for a civil engineering, the important thing is going to be about safety. As I already said, the structures were mainly of timber. The palace were also made of timber. And fire was the major issue there. In fact, surprisingly, Kautilya does not list among the 16 natural phenomena which can oppose, which are, like he calls the enemies to a country, earthquake is not listed, even though they were in Bihar. Maybe during that period, earthquakes did not occur, or maybe the wooden buildings could withstand the earthquakes. That is another matter, which over time, which has developed. We know that today, timber buildings are safe for earthquakes. Bamboo buildings are safe for earthquakes. So in the northeastern region and in the earthquake-prone region, it is quite possible they would have developed only timber for that purpose. But fire becomes an important thing. So we know that in some of the Sanskrit dramas, write that the Chandragupta's palace was burnt down due to fire. So fire safety regulations are very stringent, not like present-day regulations. And you can read Kautilya's Arthashastra itself. He says how much fine should be given if the person doesn't keep water ready with him, and how much water should be kept, and what should be the fine that has to be given, and how all the, they shall also remove thatched roofs. There can be no thatched roof because that will catch fire. Those who work by fire, that is blacksmiths or goldsmiths, shall all together live in a single locality. They cannot distribute themselves here and there. Each house owner shall ever be present at night at the door of his own house. And you know, the kindling of fire shall be prohibited during two middlemost parts of daytime, etc. A fine of 1/8 of pana shall be imposed if fire is burnt at some particular times. And there are very great details, two full chapters on how, what is fire safety. In Pataliputra it is given how much water has to be given in the square, in the road corners, in the street corners, and how much fine has to be imposed on that is given. Now, this kind of thing, the intellectual work went on, and creation of literature on Vastu and Shilpa side by side in some of the peaceful kingdoms started happening, because it becomes an issue of self-expression, not only for the intellects, but also for the kings and for the society, that they build beautiful buildings, they have good roads, they have good shops, and commercial activity can go on very well, and their temples can be beautiful, these kinds of things. So one was the skill development, the other one was the theoretical development. So at least there are about 50 books in Sanskrit, and in some local languages also, very few. There are about 50 books on Vastu and Shilpa. Many of you would have heard of Mayamata, Manasara, Vishwakarma Vastu, Shilpa Ratna, variety of such things. Among them, there is one special book called Narada Shilpa Shastra, which is only as a manuscript. But recently I edited this and brought out, because when I went through this, it was in prose, it was a very difficult prose. And this is on engineering, whereas the other texts, they write in general. It's in poetry they write, and they're all on general, and about temples and other structures they cover mostly. Whereas this text is about almost everything what a civil engineer wants, starting from how a road should be laid out, and how reconnaissance should be done, and how a well should be dug, and how a palace should be planned. I will show some of this later on. This is important because if you see the most famous text all of you would be knowing is the Brihat Samhita of Varahamihira. Varahamihira gives one chapter where he gives king's palaces of various kinds, he gives the dimension, what should be the proportion of that, what should be the height of a beam, what should be the height of a column, etc. He doesn't say why, it is only a series of numbers which are given. This would be something like a modern Indian code. If you know about Bureau of Indian Standards, they have building codes. The building codes, they don't go into the details. It is meant for quick calculation, like a thumb rule. You just go through that and you need not worry about all the textbooks or not about the mathematics which is behind it. And so some of these books which are there, including Brihat Samhita Varahamihira, it gives only a gist of how it should be. And this all come from expert knowledge or practice. And some of the interesting things in the books, if you read the theoretical books, they would say that many of the Shilpa books discuss materials and their durability. What kind of material should be used? You know that it is going to be mud, stone, and the basic thing is going to be that, and timber. These are the only thing with water. There cannot be anything else. Whichever comes from earth is called mud, so to say. Even stone will be coming from earth only. They talk about how long they can stand, whether it can be there till the end of the world, like till the Surya and Chandra remain, can I build a something, was the question they were raising. And they came to the conclusion that if we avoid joints, then it is going to stand. The example, the mountains are standing, the rocks are standing from time immemorial, and they're going to stand presumably for till the end of the pralaya also. So they decided, why don't we use the rocks directly as engineering construction? And you can see these are the cave temples. You would have heard and you would have known and seen even some of this. They don't have joints at all. They're carved or scooped out of this. And so beautifully you can get any form you want, an arch form you can get. But building an arch in this country did not come till the 14th century. Whereas what I showed in the Harappan thing was a car built construction. It was not an arch construction. But the arch form, the circular form was there because it was scooped out. It was not constructed. It was not built. And these kind of things are many, in fact. See the Mangalagiri caves in near Andhra Pradesh, and you can see some of the Buddhist monasteries and caves which are there in plenty, in fact. And art was always combined with this. This is the Mahabalipuram art, where you can see a mandapa here. Whole thing is a stone. It is a huge rock. Actually, it's a hillock. What we would call a hillock. Today, you know, people would think of the commercial thing that may come out if I quarry the stone and take the stone out, and how much I can do out of that stone for construction. Stone was needed for construction there also. But they thought of something else. That is to celebrate an ideology of nature and of water. This is the Ganga flowing from Shiva's head here. And the naturalness of art. So this is how the architectural engineering has grown. Architecture, the beauty is one thing, but how did they do this? That is engineering. What instruments they use? Because even today you can see any, a steel instrument, if it is not tempered, you do like this, it will break, the tip will break, the screwdriver will break. So they should have ordered the instruments also suitably for that. That is engineering. So you see, if we proceed like this, we come to another issue. Among the things which are standing, which you can go visit and see, it is going to be the temples, the monumental temples which are remaining, which you can appreciate to a large extent, unless you have the eye to go to villages and see some of the old houses and see how they lived and what kind of architecture they had. Particularly in Kerala, they have been very well preserved. And in West Coast, in Karnataka also, some of these houses are preserved. But in the urban areas, nothing, at least in Bangalore and other places, I haven't been able to see such old things. But we can see the temples. So this becomes another way of looking at our architectural engineering heritage. But this is not the only way, let us remember. I'm showing here a plan of a town called Srirangam. Srirangam is a town, but people know more about Srirangam temple than about the town. So the town is a seven layered town, seven rounds are there, the prakaras. Inside is the famous Srirangam temple. Tourists who go, of course, they will simply go into the temple, visit and come back. But what about the people who are living? What was the town plan which went into this? How are the commercial activities done? How are the civic activities done? How the governance is done? These are all some of the very important issues. In that, the ancient, if you get into the planning aspect of this, very, very interesting things come out. Normally, we look at only the outer form and forget about it. But if you see the particular issues which are involved, see, this is a gopuram. This is a temple gopuram, anybody would say. But is this total thing gopuram from the ground up to this or something else? Actually, the gopuram originally was only from this part up to the height. Whereas from the ground up to this point, that is the entry point, was called a pratoli. So the pratolis were the more important thing. They were simply like gateways. And it was not just a single gateway, but it had some internal thing where people could sit, people could do some commercial activity. And the towns developed, the villages developed. They would construct some important points, a new area, a new site, some 4, 5, 10, 16 pratolis, and invite people to come and build their own house and do their commercial activity. The people would come with their wares, the vegetables or the milk, and then try to sell. Then other people will come and buy that. And that's how it grew. And that is why in many of our older villages, you don't see roads connecting as the modern roads, but there will be lanes, which will be from one pratoli, if you look at it carefully, to another pratoli. So this is how the town planning started in ancient India. And talking of temples, since I'm addressing the Sri Sri University in Orissa online from a distance, I thought I should say something on this. This is in fact as in the introduction I had written, is awe-inspiring structure. Now, about the architecture is one thing, the beauty, but how did they imagine this? How did they envisage this? How did they plan about this? But this is one thing which in our engineering courses is missing. Nobody talks about this. They will take for maybe for a tour or so, show this, and then talk about the Indian architecture as written in Fulton's book or in some Westerner's book, and not bother about and make a comparison with Greek architecture or Roman architecture with the Hindu architecture and forget about it. The issue is not so simple, and it should not be done like that. You would see how did they get the circles? How did they get the alignment? How did they envisage this? Did he have a drawing or did he not have a drawing? How did he get the east-west line? Was some astronomy involved in it? These questions have to be raised. Today, of course, they would do a surveying and then say, okay, you I fix the east-west line and draw it, and then the building goes on like that. But in the ancient time, what did they do? They equally well they did it, because otherwise they would not have got that accuracy. This we know where to, we owe. All engineers in this country, IKS people, owe to Alice Bonar, a Swiss lady. She made this country as her hometown. In Kashi she lived all through her life. And she went on investigating Indian art. She has written very beautiful books. I will not go into all of that. One of this is The New Light on the Temple at Konark. So she unearthed it, along with some local people, and lifelong she has worked on this. And what she did, her passion was this. She found out, her question was this, what the question I raised. How did they envisage this? How did they get that accuracy in all of these things? She unearthed palm leaf manuscripts. This is a palm leaf manuscript. When I show this to the people, people don't believe. They think it should be an engineering drawing. Indeed, it is. Indeed, it is an engineering drawing, not done on a big size drawing paper with T square and a plane table and all of that. But they did this on palm leaf. And you can see there are 10 palm leaves here. One after another, if you put up, you get a scale drawing. And you, many of you, well, I'm sure you all of you know that this part is missing today in the temple. The Shikhara part above the Garbhagriha. But you can see that here. If at all somebody want to reconstruct, they can do it from this. That's another matter. And you can see this is actually a chariot. And the chariot is drawn by the horses and the wheels are there, and a wonderful way of representing. And the Rathotsava, even in Puri, Jagannath, the Rathotsava and all that done. Some of the Rathas, if you see the architectural pattern, not there, but in other temples, they follow this. Or maybe from the Ratha pattern, he designed the temple should be like a chariot, I don't know. And the further palm leaf manuscripts are like this. This is the east-west orientation from the shadow. You know, the Chaya Ganita, in astronomy, it is in discussed in great detail. That is, depending on the sun shadow, you can fix the east-west line and other lines. And all these are given. And this is the plan, the ground plan. See, as engineers, we learn first the plan, the elevation. Everything is available in this. And we went to such a detail. It's called the Padmakesar Temple in the text. This is actually an ancient Varian script, but in Sanskrit language. You see the wheel details, and the wheel detail involves the spoke. The how the spoke should be designed is all in stone, but also he has given in detail. So this lady, Alice Bonar, went to such an extent, she wanted to compare the actual standing column with the column which is there in the diagram, in the palm leaf manuscript. And that seems matching, wonderfully matches. You can read the book in greater detail if you are interested. Now, there is also a diary which is kept. In all project today, we know that we have to keep a side diary. The side diary gives the account, how much money was paid to whom, and the name of the people. This is one where the Sutradhara name is known. Sadashiva Santara Mahapatra Sutradhara, he received, and the chief, the Narayana Mahapatra, received his salary like that. How much salary they received, that is also given. The names of the people are given. If it was an eclipse day, that is mentioned, and what Shanti was done. And this book itself is only about 10 pages or so, kept only for the last 6 years. The total number of years was about 12 years. The first 6 years, maybe it is last, we do not know. It is unparalleled in history. This was in the 13th century. In fact, Alice Bono says, even for the European churches, no such information is available, which were built roughly in the same period, the Byzantine churches. And the it goes to such an extent for blasting of stone, how much money was given, for shifting of the stone, how much money was given. And how did they bring the stone? Many of you would have visited this place, and it is in the coast, and no stone is directly available there. How did they do that? They brought it from the hills, some of which are 100 kilometers away. So these are the names of the hills. I will not read them. See, actually, the temple is here, is the sea coast. They had to come along some of the natural rivers up to some point. Then they had to dig channels. They have dug channels from here. And how did they transport? On boats. What kind of boats? Because stones are going to be so heavy, if you have seen, they will weigh something like 100 tons or 200 tons like that. How did they transport it? They built special boats. These are the special boats where you put so many boats side by side, side by side. Like you would have heard stories of elephants being transported in boats, so that you should know how many boats are required to transport an elephant or so. Like that, they transported. In other words, any large project, even today, suppose you go to an automobile industry, they'll say tool making. Special tools have to be done to get a particular kind of thing. Same thing in monumental structures. And they developed their own tools. These are the tools which they developed. For example, how to lift the stone up. There is, of course, a scaffolding was done. And the scaffolding you have to do by counterweight, you have to lift up. But how do you get the counterweight lifting? People can draw, but you need a counterweight. Use the elephants intelligently. So the elephants were used to lift it up. But in all cases, was that possible? No, it was not. They developed something like a jack. The jack is shown here below. Like, you know, what we use if the tire is punctured in our car. No, you keep a jack and lift it. By a few feet, you can lift it. Similar thing was done, and you know, the jack is shown here. It's a mechanical jack. Keep a stone, keep on pressing it. It will rise about a meter or so. Then take a platform, push it, take the system there, and once again, keep on doing it. This is how it was done. So hoisting of such heavy things was done in a very intelligent way. I'm showing this because you know that Bradeeshwara temple in Thanjavur is another example where a very heavy stone has been moved. And it is well established there. They used an inclined plane about 8 kilometers long from a village. They built a ramp, mud ramp, and they used elephants and others to push slowly the stone up to that height. Here, they used a different way. This is not very high, not as high as in Bradeeshwara temple, but nevertheless, the weight was there. And all this was audited, and the auditor put their sign also. So the symbols are also there. And this itself is an engineering record. And this is a great or what you can say, a possession of this country, properly kept, an inspiration of IKS, so to say. And the story doesn't stop there. The story is, this is a question of national integration. Because the queen was from Madurai. It's a Tamil-speaking lady. And the king was Narasimha Varman in Orissa. Some of the sculptors came from south, and they had their own way of showing this. And this diary records all of that. Who came from Madurai? What was the problem between them and the local people? And how they finally sorted out? And what kind of work they did? And how the integration happened also. Now, this is not only about Konark. Konark, we have the record, courtesy Alice Bonar, a foreigner, for that example. But if you search our own monuments, you see some of them even now. This is something like a jewel box. If I reduce the scale, it looks like a jewel box. This is the Belur temple, 12th century, the Hoysala style temple. It is the plan. And the diagram, the scales are given here. See, it is always the proportion which is important. It is not the absolute value. Remember, many of you would be musicians here. You know that in music, it is the relative shruti which matters with reference to the other shruti. And it is not the absolute value of the frequency for any raga for that matter. It is the ratio which matters. And that ratio concept is there from the Samaveda time, not only in singing and in that, but in all cases, in everywhere, in road, in buildings, in palaces, it is a ratio which mattered, which appeals to the eye and to the mind and for construction purposes. It is not the absolute width, not a huge building has to be done. The idea was not like that. Because the proportion has to be looked at. For that, the scale has to be there. The scale is etched in many other places. Now, I'll briefly show you a few slides on the Narada Shilpa, a few of them, because many do not know about the engineering issues which are there in our Shilpa Shastra text. See, the Mayamata, Kashyapa Shilpa, Samarangana Sutra Dara, they don't talk of construction. They talk of only the broad details, like the ratios, like how many stories have to be built. Suppose you ask, you have to build a gopura. They will simply say, use your intelligence and build a gopura. But Narada Shilpa says how it should be done, what elements have to be done, where you have to keep a ladder, and how they should go and stand there and systematically work, whether it should be a false door or it should be a real door for architectural purposes. And not only that, all aspects of engineering like planning, roads, water resources, town planning are covered in the first 50 lessons. Then residences, palaces, furniture, law courts, art gallery, and theater. Any cultured civilization will have not only a palace. You see, if you read some of the ancient stories and also the Sanskrit dramas particularly, which are placed around Ujjaini or Pataliputra, even Kanchipuram and other towns, you see that there are beautiful palaces and there are beautiful buildings and, you know, people going in the evening to music halls or to art galleries or to see some drama kind of thing. But were they really true or is it only a poetical imagination, one may ask? Now, Bharatanatya Shastra is such a fantastic book. It also talks about theater and how a theater should be constructed. But were there such things? What was the details of that? That is available in Narada Shilpa Shastra, actually. Not only temple and iconography is very little in this, but the kind of internal decoration. And we know that people had law courts. Justice was very important. But how the building was that? It needs a building also. And all this in a very systematic, but in a crisp way is covered in Narada Shilpa. Naturally, I can't go into the whole text. It also starts with the Vastu Mandala, a square shape of building, a square shape of plan, where always the central part is kept open. Now, many have wondered why they had this. Why did they have to have this kind of thing? Let me tell you quickly. This is only a coordinate axis. Like in modern drawing, we do x-axis, y-axis in a two-dimensional Cartesian plane and say that you proceed maybe 10 inches along the x-axis, then 1 meter along the y-axis, you get something. Here, the same thing. Brahma is the central part. If you say that you go to Ballata will be somewhere here. You have to put a door here, if he says, or don't put a road. Or if he says you go to Yatu and then do some work, that will be somewhere here. So it is a coordinate system. The coordinate system was given names, not in terms of numbers of distances, because it is againly ratio which mattered. Always is square. Suppose you wanted a rectangle, put another square by the side of it, of a different dimension. Then the combined is going to be something like a rectangle. So the principle was that. Whether it is right or wrong is a different matter, but the principle was that. Now, based on it, see, this is the plan of a law court. This I have produced on an AutoCAD drawing. The drawing is not available in the book, but the description is so detailed, where the mandapa should be there, where the king should be seated, how many steps should be there for that place, and from the ground level, how people enter and through how many steps they go up, and then where the officials are sitting and where they have to record the witnesses or the lawyers or the people who plead for them, the adhikarnikas, for some unlettered people or people who do not know. And always these are all at elevated levels. They're never at the ground level. Eventually they go up, go up, go up. The steps are also given, how many steps and what kind of cover has to be given, how many columns have to be there. And you know, the gallery type of thing where the officials who present the case are standing or sitting, where the complaints and their people are sitting and standing on this side. The judges here and the jurors or the people who made a committee to inquire, they are sitting here. And then above this is going to be the king or the seat of the king. And this is how this is described. And this is more or less what comes up in some of the Sanskrit dramas. Like in Shudraka's Mrichakatika, there is a scene where a judge is questioning a person. So these things fit in there. And there is a public theater. This is public theater. How it is done? It is in three levels. And this is the ground level, people enter. Then, you know, this is going to be the actual auditorium. And this is the stage here. And this is called the Natakshala. So the Natakshala, there are of different kinds for the devas and also for the kings, but also for the common man. This is called the Gandharva Natakshala. Here anybody can come and watch the drama. And you would see there is a small bird here. I can't show it in this diagram. This is only an architect's reconstruction of that. The bird would indicate that there is something which is public. There is something which is interesting. People can go. During some of the village jatras, there are going to be tents. And the tent at the top, they would keep some bird or some other symbol or a small flag so that people from a distance know something is available there and they go. So similar kind of thing is done. They also had a Chitrashala. This was a palace. How are the ancient palaces? The palace layout is given in great detail. I have not put the roof and where the visitors have to come, where the samantas have to be sitting, how many doors have to be there. If it is the main king, the emperor who is there, his palace will have 12 doors. Through 12 pratolis or doorways, the person had to pass. And there will be, of course, as you would have seen in some of the TV shows also, people, the security guards and others. There is also a Ganta Shala here, where they would beat and announce the time. And very interestingly, the crown horse and the crown elephant have to be here, in these two places very near. Because every day, the king has to either come and see them, or they come and stand here at the center, so that the king can see them, the crown horse and the crown elephant. That is mentioned in the text. It has to be there only so that it is called Adhoranam. That Adhoranam has to be done. But that word has gone out of Chalti nowadays. Nobody knows what is Adhoranam. Unless you see the ancient Sanskrit dictionaries, you will not know. And the king's private thing will be here. His residence is, here. It is here. So whenever he has to take rest, he can come. But this is not the Queen's Palace. Queen's Palace is here in a separate place. It's a five-layered, covered kind of building. Once again, it's in great detail of what has to be there. I can construct another diagram for it, which I have not done. So this is how this text is there, Narada Shilpa. That is why Narada Shilpa is something which can be adapted for teaching in modern days also. systematically, so that some of these concepts, I won't say all of them, but some concepts can be definitely used even today. And you know, the palace door is given in great detail, because the ancient palace doors you can see in Mysore Palace, Rajasthan palaces, they're beautiful palaces. And this is again from an artist, I got it drawn. And all the details are given in the Sanskrit text itself. What kind of flower should be there, whether it has to be a swan or it has to be some other, or maybe a peacock can be there, or it may be a kali. What kind of animals can be shown on this? All these details are available. And inside the palace, you'd be wondering, how did the ventilation manage, the sunlight and ventilation? There were many of these things were open, and the ventilation was through this kind of pankha. Pankha, some of you would be knowing, they're hand-operated pankha. I'm showing here a diagram because I could not get anything else. In the 18th century, is British people who had these pankhas had to be drawn manually by servants. About 150 years back, this was the system even in some of the revenue offices. And that is described here. Arka panjaram bauma vala bejita vatayana kalpana pata panktikam. So it's a full fan system, and arka panjara is going to be sun lantern for light to come in. Can't go into all the details, but this is how the text discusses all this. Now, why I'm showing Taj Mahal, it's a famous thing. There is a paper on this, New Insight on Modular Planning of Taj Mahal. The square pattern is a modular pattern. You have large number of squares you can add, keep on adding, and you can get any shape you want. This is a paper by a scientist, Balasubramanian, no more, he was in IIT Kanpur. And he shows that all the modules there, even though finally it looks like this is a satellite imagery, satellite image looks rectangle. But this rectangle is formed out of special squares of particular dimensions. So this is very important. And the roofing was also done in the same way, like the car build system. I showed in the first one, the Harappans had, you bring two stones nearby, 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 you get something like an arch, but it's not an arch. Now, how did they get arch vimanas or this kind of shell vimanas in ancient time for the temples? There are such temples. This is from Karnataka, actually. Inside it would look like this, like a shell. What they did was this. The same concept they extended, and Narada Shilpa discusses this. It's called Konantarita design. Each rectangle or a square or an octagon is shifted by an angle, slightly, 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 and each dimension is reduced, and then turn. Then you get outside a shape like this, which would look like a shell from a distance. But inside, it would look like this. And you don't have, this is the bare thing which I'm showing here, but you can decorate it the way you want it, and then it would look beautiful. So it is the art and the structural form. The structural design were obtained by trial and error. There was no mechanics in those days, so you can't have an analysis, but by experiment they did it. But the regular arch and the shell came from outside. You see, the Indian engineering, the sculptors or the people, the sthapatis, they would absorb. In fact, Indian knowledge system has never said no to any new knowledge, which if it is useful, which is coming into the country. And in around the 12th, 13th century, whatever may be the physical reasons, the concept of shells came into this country. That is in Bijapur and Gulbarga. These were artisans who came from Persia who did this construction. This was taken up by the local artisans, and you can see the historical development in the Vijayanagar period, where they combined both the shell construction as well as the arch construction. This internal thing was like this, their age-old Konantarita construction. Maybe they were a little bit afraid. They did not want to use it immediately. But lawyer, they were quite confident they can have this kind of design, because these are the elephant stables. Elephant stable requires large width and quite a bit of height also. Now, there is a very curious thing of technology transfer in the 17th century in civil engineering. this transfer happened from India to UK, that is to England. Even in 1714, of course, still it was not the period of, you can say, the Sipai War and all of that becoming a full-fledged colony. It was the initial period of the East India Company and all that. Then there was a governor from St. Helena, that is from West Indies, who visited Madras. He came to East Indies. And he visited a building which was under construction. I will show that. That was a church. That was the first church they built east of Egypt, east of Suez Canal. And that church construction was done by local Hindu architects and constructors. The architecture was different. The planning was different. I will show that. And it was so important for them, the details. This was published in the Royal Society. See, today to publish a paper in the Royal Society Journal is considered the pinnacle of science. And this they published in there. And one of the authors was Edmund Halley. He was the vice president of the Royal Society and was an astronomer. He contributed to this. These two people joined together. That Isaac Pike was the governor general of St. Helena, who was a politician. And these two wrote this because some knowledge they thought should be transferred. And that was the method of making the best mortar at Madras in East India. So the best mortar in the world, according to them, was done in India. And how it is done is nothing but what is given in the Vastu books. Like dissolve 20 pounds of jaggery, which is a coarse sugar in water, then put liquor over the mortar. That is going to be only with limestone, how it should be burnt, and how you put other grams, that is going to be urad gram and other grams into that, how it has to be mixed, how much time it has to ferment, how it has to be turned around and to produce the mortar, and how it has to be pure white in color, how it has to be applied in several coats. And he says he was so surprised with this. There were no joints at all, and to any height it could be taken. And he says that this is much better than the plaster of Paris we see, like the stucco work, better than the best stucco work, he writes. You can go through this in greater detail. Then how to apply the second coat and how the arched work was done and how it has to be mixed. For example, there is, says, let it be ground at travel full at a time on a stone with a stone roller, like you make chutney or whatever, or ground in England and let it, as a stone roller in the same manner that chocolate is usually made or ground in England. So he gives a comparison how it has to be done. All this way I'm saying, it's all organic material, what they were using. And the organic building materials is a big industry today. This was the time when Portland cement was not there. Portland cement came only towards 1870 or so. From England only it came. Now, of course, everything is using Portland cement. But at that time, it was all lime mortar, lime, brick, and stone. And all the organic materials which are mentioned here, they'll be chemically analyzed. And now they are available, manufactured in large quantities, and supplied. And there are some funny instances also. I will not go into that. The building he's talking is this. This is the St. Mary's Church, Fort St. George, the oldest Anglican church east of Suez, 1670 to 1680, this was constructed. So when he visited, the steeple was being constructed at that time. But this is what he is referring to. And you see, this has a particular shape, a plan, and all that. And you see the present-day buildings which are there in Madras like this. Now, the forum, of course, today got messed up. The ancient and the modern and so on and so forth. So the individuality is lost. But in those days, they were very particular of that. So the best sort of whitening varnish is thus made. Varnish is, we go and buy it from the shop nowadays. How it was done, take 1 gallon of toddy and buttermilk and chunam or lime and prepare and make a liquor out of it and keep it and then use that, you get the best whitewash, is what he is telling. Well, anyway, this is one aspect. In the next few minutes that is available to me, I think some 15 minutes would be available perhaps, I will cover about a little bit about water quickly, okay? The organizer has to tell me when I have to stop. This I am taking from Narada Shilpa.
Dr. Iyengar, I'm sorry to intervene. We have 20 more minutes for the session to close.
I have 20 minutes.
20 minutes more for the session to close.
Okay.
In case you want to take some question answers in those 20 minutes.
Okay, I will do that. I will quickly finish. Another 10 minutes, I will finish that. The water resources are not discussed in other Shilpa books, but Narada Shilpa has this, and it gives the construction of a chak dam. Not a big dam, but a chak dam, a small dam. And you know, these kinds of dams are in plenty, in thousands in our country. In fact, Karnataka itself has about 40,000 such chak dams. I'm sure all over India it will be there. Why this water is important? We have a legacy of hydraulic engineering starting from the Harappan period. This is the water supply system in Dholavira. If you go there physically, I have gone there and seen these things. You have an outer, because people are living in fort. So the fort door would be closed. How did they get their water? And if the enemy is outside, what were they doing? These questions come up. They had got the outer, their 16 tanks, which filled up during the monsoon season. That was sufficient for about 20,000 people who were living in the inside the fort. And they had dug channels like this from outside to inside, and there is a well inside. And this well will have water always because it gets water from outside. And the well is still there in Dholavira. You can go and see. And the rope marks are also there on the on the well. And this system was pursued continuously for the last about 5,000 years. Importance of water. And you can see the wells which are there in Kalibangan, so that they were stiffened. So engineering, the structural engineering grew like this slowly, both came together, and we have the most beautiful structures here. This is the Ranikavav in Patan, which is six-story building down. Now we talk of multi-story buildings and things so high of them and all that. This is actually a six-story building. And for water, they had to go deep. But the water was available to the commoner also, because you could draw from outside in a well, even though the Ranima and those people would go inside, also temples inside. And this is a structure, let us understand it. It is not just about architecture. They have to know how to balance the beams, how to keep the load coming, and how it has to be distributed. That is all known by their practice. And there are plenty of such structures in this country. And water purifying, water supply systems in Sringiberapura. These are all well documented, so I will not go into that. There are a book available by B.B. Lal, who was a famous archaeologist who investigated the Mahabharata sites. And he showed that how water was purified, how the settling tanks were done near Ganga, so that the monsoon water comes there, settles. Then it overflows. So the mud would sink down and it overflows and goes to the next well, and where people can come and take the pure water. They won't go here. They will go to this place. And if this also overflows, that water will not go waste. That will once again go to the Ganga. Another canal would be there. It goes and joins the overflow things. And there are such structures in this country. Bridges. This bridge is from Puri near Cuttack. Built in 11th and 12th century. And this is aqueduct. A bridge is not just for human beings, but we want for water transportation. Water was transported because from one level to another level. This is in Vijayanagar. And bridges of different kinds, depending on the material. This is from Arunachal Pradesh, where bamboo and iron chains were used. Iron, like this, a net arrangement. In iron, this is shown, but the same arrangement is done in bamboo. in other places where if the load is not very heavy, if the span is short, one can use a bamboo bridge. It's a suspension bridge like this. Of course, the Mughal period bridges are still standing, where the architecture slightly changed. And this is a bridge near Srirangapatnam in Kaveri, which was built only stone. Now, of course, it's not functional, but the architecture of the bridge is interesting, how they transported the load and other things. There are also dams which are there. I have no time to go through the dams or the anikats, because they did not do as the Westerners did. They always had their own way of designing so that the silt does not settle. So they would be inclined along the flow of the river. They would build a dam so that the water gets collected and on one side the irrigation can be done. It's a typical example of the Kallanai near Srirangam, which was built in 200 AD. And the dam was never straight. This is in plan I am showing. It was a sinusoidal in plan. It's a curved in plan. And the height was not uniform. One side is tall, one side is less. So that the water which gets collected on one side overflows onto the, for irrigation purposes. But this changed, the British changed it. And then finally, you know, they brought over that they built. If you go there, you would see only this structure. You will not see the old structure. Out of box thinking has vanished in this country. Now with the new NEP which is coming in, I do hope there is going to be a combination of the knowledge. So this is, I'm showing from Himalayas, is a Buddhist structure. It's a new monastery. Nothing of the architecture or the plan or of the shape or of the colors is changed. Only the material is different. The building material is cement. Cement concrete. With that it is built. And this kind of thing is very necessary. We were never against a particular material to be used. For example, there are stone temples, there are mud temples, there are going to be brick temples, construction, depending on the material that is available. So this is an important aspect. I will end this with a short story and then, you know, we can take questions. This story is said is actually not a story. It is a historical event which is explained in Rajatarangini. The Rajatarangini is again a wonderful book for various reasons. Can't go into the details, but for my purpose, because I looked into it for natural events, earthquakes, floods, landslides, particularly earthquakes, then I came across this. In 883 AD, there was an earthquake. And in that earthquake, there was a severe landslide and Jhelum Ghat River blocked. And the water did not flow. And there was no agriculture that could be done. And all the villagers on the two banks, they were all completely upset. They rose in rebellion against the king. And the king did not know what to do. He consulted so many people, but nobody could give an answer for him. But then there was one fellow who looked like a mad fellow. It's called Suya. He would go into all the temples. He would go into all the things because he was an intelligent fellow. He knew how to mix with people. He said, I know the way. I know the solution for this. I know the solution. But I don't have the wherewithal to do that. Then, you know, the ministers took him to the king. And the king also, he said the same thing. The minister said, this is a mad fellow. Don't listen to him. But the king said, the details are, Avanti Varma also is there. The details are there. He said, no, let me ask what he wants. He said, I want some 10 parts of Dinara. Dinara is the gold coin, the money which was used. He said, okay, give it. 10 parts of dinara was given. He went to that place, the Madarajya, the details are there. He put all that part into water. All the villagers who are standing there watching what this fellow is doing, they simply jumped inside because they wanted the gold. So they pushed all the stones onto one side and they collected the money. Indicates that after a natural disaster, you have to give work. Employment is very important. You know, employment is important because they need money. Otherwise, what do they do? So the employment this fellow decided was to see that they work on the stone. On their own, they would not remove it. But because of this money, They all went out. They pushed the stones out. Then he told them, look, I will give you further. You work with me. So he put a bund, a stone bund. It seems it is still standing there. For about 1,000 years, it's still standing. And then the king was so happy with him. The water flowed and everything was perfectly fine. The king asked him, you come and work with me. He became the engineer, the chief engineer in his place. And in his memory, the king built a town called Suryapura. Nowadays, it is called Sopor. And let us not go into the unfortunate issues along associated with Sopor. But there are the times when engineers are going to be honored, not just putting a memorial or giving an award, but a town was built. That was the spirit of this country. And respecting not only the theory of architecture and engineering, but also the people who work with, the common people, the sthapatis, the sutradharas, the sutrakaras, the lohakaras, the karmakaras, and they were also equally important. And in fact, it is they, I would say, who have preserved the architectural engineering heritage of this country, which of course we go to the temples and wonder about it, but we have to think about who did this, how did it. It is not just the king. It is the people who designed it. Now, this is my concluding remarks. I will not read them. I'm sure you will all know about it. There are many critical, published and unpublished Vastu texts still. If we do a comparison, we'll have a better appreciation of our own development of architecture and engineering in India. The last conclusion is the spiritual idea of Shilpa and Vastu. This has come from the Vedic period. It's a distinct Indian knowledge system. The ideal is to plan rural and urban habitat, construct residence, private building, water resource, amenities, whatever it is, so that this country has become a civilization, a culture which is a civilization culture because of this ideal, so that the occupants and citizens at large are in harmony with nature, and the Vedic ideal was to be in harmony with the larger cosmic space. That is how the Vastu Mandala and those, all those things are brought in, and also the rituals, so that we know that we are always in a one-to-one relationship with the Bhumi or with the earth, with the Mother Earth. Whereas the Dyauhu Pita, the Pita was in this, is the sky, whereas the earth is the mother. This is the spirit with which architecture and engineering has developed in India. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Angerji. And I'm sure everybody is really enthralled. Maybe participants, I would request you could put questions. Dr. Anuradha, would you like to moderate the question answer session? I would request Dr. Anuradha to moderate the question answer session.
You have to speak a little bit loud. Please speak a little bit loud.
Dr. Anuradha, I would request you to moderate the question answer session, and we could close the session at 11.
Yes. Sir, I'm going to speak for about 7 minutes, and I'll try and see if I can bring forth maximum number.
Dr. Anuradha, there is an echo. Are you logged in with the two devices?
You put it in a chat, or somebody can tell me the question.
Yes. Okay. There was an echo in her voice till the time she.
I can stop my.
Yes, sir. Maybe you could stop your presentation. I'll take a question till Dr. Anuradha joins in.
I'm back, Richaji.
Okay, yes.
Okay. So here the question is by Kshitiji, who's saying that at present the vocabulary we use to study architecture is far away from IKS. From where would you suggest that we should start studying Indian vocabulary mentioned in original traditional texts, since we are not well versed with Sanskrit? So you're muted, sir. So you're still muted, sir. Your mic is muted, sir.
No, can you put your question on a chat?
So the questions are already on the chat. On the chat, all the participants have put in their questions, sir.
Oh, really? I didn't see that. Oh,
yes. Okay. Would you like to stop sharing your screen so then you can have one? It'll be easier for you to also see the chats and all.
Oh, I don't know how to get the chat here.
All right. Would you like to stop sharing, sir? Or Shalini,
stop sharing.
Okay. Yes. Then okay. You will. We'll be able to see you. And then you can.
Yeah, I have stopped sharing. Yeah.
Yes. Wonderful. Wonderful. So now, can you see the chats? If you go down, then you can see the chats. And if you'd like to choose from there, there's a lot of appreciation that's coming in. Yes, sir.
Okay.
So there was, would you like to choose or would you like me to pick up for you?
You can pick up for me, you know. Yes.
So one is regarding the vocabulary of architecture. How do people who are not familiar with Sanskrit, how can we help them, be familiar with the terminologies that are there?
Okay. Yeah. There is a handbook on architecture written by P.K. Acharya. That's available freely on archive.org. It is called the Encyclopedia of Indian Architecture. It was written in the 1940s. It's a little bit outdated, but still one can start with that. And there is also an additional something like an appendix for that by Anand Kumar Swami, a famous artist and a scientist. So one can start with it. Second, in the Narada Shilpa that I have edited, I have prepared an index of the technical terms. So the technical terms, if you see the translation, you will be in a position to follow to some extent. But it is really necessary that somebody should take, should prepare a handbook of Vastu terminology with figures, with explanations and all that. Yeah, next one.
There is a question by Sarikaji who's saying that there are, what were the basic principles of iconography in ancient Indian architecture? And what was the role of iconography apart from the aesthetic appeal? Can you suggest some texts for diving deep into iconography and craftsmanship?
See, for iconography, there are many texts which are available, very beautiful texts. For example, there is one by Shivaram Murthy, written in the 30s and 40s, but they discuss all the proportions, etc., which are taken even from some of the Puranas. So, for example, our Puranas themselves, some of them talk about architecture and iconography. See, Vishnu Dharmottara Purana has several chapters on art, how to do that. So one will have to go into the details, you know. But you will get large number of books on iconography, more on rather than on construction of buildings or temples. So iconography is not only metal iconography, metallic, but a sculpting stone with stone. You will get that. And again, I would say if some of you who are interested in this deeply, you can send me an email. I showed the email on the first slide. And you can write to me. I'll be very happy to respond.
Yes, so we'll make all the questions available because the time is so short, we'll not be able to address all of them. But just one question was also regarding the Kailashnath temple, sir.
Uh-huh.
How did they build that monolithic structure of the Kailashnath temple?
Hmm. How did they do that?
Yes, sir.
I wish I knew. See, this is the right forum to talk about it also. We feel so happy, proud about our country and about what is there and about what others say about our country. But we don't take interest in investigating that. So that investigation has to be done about the past. It is not just about history of the kings and about date and all that. But how did they do that? The Kailasanath temple? Yeah, it's a very interesting question. That has to be done. Somebody has to work on it.
Sorry, there was also a question by Vlatkaji who's asking about how can we use, because a lot of the materials you spoke about earlier are natural materials. So how can we bring in that in the structures of North India? So that was her question. Is there any material that we can study for today's sustainable nature building in mountains of North India, Uttarakhand near Nainital?
You mean the ancient materials to be
used? Yes.
You see, the way the ancient materials were used, they were known to the artisans because they developed it by trial and error. Some general principles are known, as I showed for the martyr, Madras martyr. Whereas in the books, they are not given, but this person, because he was interested in knowing, he takes about the proportion, he writes how much time it has to be done and all that. Whereas in our books, such details are not there. You would see by this time, you would have understood the difference between our approach and an analytical approach. An approach of synthesis and an approach of analysis. Both have to be combined. So if I had to succeed as in a new IKS in this area, we have to be analytical also. And from ancient materials, you'll have to investigate them. You have to subject it to testing. You know, organic materials, there are building material labs. They have to test those material and come to the conclusion what it is. Westerners do this. In fact, many of the materials which come under some patented things, you would know, not going to talk about neem and turmeric, but so many other things, the colors. There are natural colors and we've been doing that. Only thing is it is not protected. Or if somebody knew how to do it, he won't tell others. That is how it has happened. So the ancient materials in a vast country like this, there cannot be a single material. It has to be different materials which are locally available. And the local availability depends on time. We are talking of a civilization which is 5,000 years, not about 100 years or 200 years. So with time, the political situation, the economic situation changes, people go to different place and they look for the local material which is available and the local environment and the weather. So the kind of weather which is there in Kerala, that won't fit in. I mean, that kind of architecture will not be practiced in northeastern region or in Uttar Pradesh for obvious reasons. And the soil condition is different. In north, you know, the Gangetic Valley is so rich and fertile, the bricks are like stone, the burnt bricks. Whereas in the south, the bricks are weak. This is because of geological variations. So many variations we'll have to consider. But the whole subject is a very deep subject. It's a field by itself. You know. But somewhere the link has to come in. The educational program, at least, a window can be opened, a small window to the ancient practices, to the ancient materials and the ancient books. You know. So that way, slowly, some new people would come in, creative people, they will do things in their own way.
Yes, sir. Sir, I'm afraid we've run out of time. There are still many very interesting questions by the various participants. And so as you have been very generous, we'll try and share all these questions with you and we'll share your contact details so that I'm sure that many of the participants would like to learn and also to implement what, you know, the knowledge that you have in their own respective ways, wherever they are. So I think with these few words, I would again offer our collective pranams and say we look forward to your continued guidance for many such events in the future. And I hand it over to Richaji. She'd like to say something and close.
Thank you, Professor Angerji, for shedding all the light and your vast experience and knowledge. And you have said something very beautiful, that we need to open small windows of our ancient knowledge systems into the mainstream academia. And I'm sure with this FTP, small steps will be taken in that direction by all of us. So we will connect with you, sir, and we will share your email ID with the participants, and I will write to you today evening, sir.
Thank you. Thanks. I'm so happy. Please be in touch with me. You can send me the email.
Yes.
Along with the questions, I will try to respond. Yes. If their emails are available, I can respond individually. Sure. Otherwise, I'll respond in general.
Yes, yes, sir. We can collate all the questions and send to you. Okay. And your responses, we can share from our ends with all the participants.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Namaste, sir.
Thank you. Take leave of.
Thank you, sir. So we will have the second session at 11:30, which was originally titled as Bunna or Banana, Weaving and Knitting, but now it is called The Hand Woven and the Handmade by Professor Archana Shastriji. She was in NIFT, Delhi. So we will start the session at 11:30. Please take a break, refresh yourself,
okay,
and enjoy break. Namaste.
Namaskar, I'm sorry.
I hope your health is doing well, huh? I understood you were not doing well.
Yes, a bad throat. But, I'm trying to just open my PowerPoint.
In the meantime, Dr. Anuradha Chaudhary ji will introduce you.
Namaste, ma'am.
Namaste, Anuradha ji.
So, would you like to test also your presentation in the meanwhile if it's working? So, short note about Professor Archana Shastri. Each of our speakers, as you have realized till now, are extremely eminent scholars in their respective fields. And their vast experience in terms of just their associations, the publication works that they have, and all are very long. But to give them more time for their presentations, we just keep their introductions brief. So Dr. Professor Archana Shastri completed her Master's in Fashion MFA from MS University Fellowship in Visual Communication at the National Institute of Design, Ahmedabad, Advanced Printmaking from Royal College of Art, London, and Fashion Orientation Program at the Fashion Institute of Technology in New York. She held several one-person and group show of drawings, paintings, and prints. Her major collection of works with Ibrahim Alkazi and with the late Chester Hurwitz was represented in various museums. She taught for 20 years at NIFT, Delhi, as professor and chairperson, fashion design and fashion communication departments. She intermittently served as a reader art education with NCRT for 2 years on Lien. She was the principal of Government College of Art, Chandigarh, on deputation and served as HOD of the Kaladarshana or Kaladarshana at ITNCA. She has been a visiting faculty in all premier educational institutes of fashion design, art, craft, and theater. She's the former director, Mekong Ganga Cooperation Asian Traditional Textile Museum, Siem Reap, Cambodia. We're extremely privileged to have you, ma'am, to speak to us this morning. And the topic that you will be talking is on the hand woven and the handmade. A quick note on the session itself. The session will trace the origin and practice of the hand woven and the handmade through the pre-industrial, industrial, and post-industrial phase of society. While the early self-reliant colonies were responsible for harnessing the available natural resources into creating low volume and sustainable products for daily subsistence, industrialization sounded the death knell of handmade goods. The post-industrial age witnessed the widespread blurring of geographical territories through centralized production and circulation of goods, leading to loss or diffusion of cultural identities. However, in the face of homogenization and mass production, the handmade has only added value to the currency. In the present scenario of COVID, since excessive consumerism would be discouraged, the limited production of handmade may have reason for regaining its popularity. Ma'am, with these few words, over to you, and we look forward eagerly to listen to your sharing. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Can you see the screen?
Not yet, ma'am. Not yet.
I've already.
Would you like to add anything?
No.
If you click the share button, have you found that, ma'am?
Yeah. So, Archana, ma'am, you are the co-host now. So, once you click on the green button at the bottom, share screen.
Actually, it's not showing the green button.
Okay. Aditya, ma'am is the co-host now, right?
Yes, ma'am. She's the co-host.
Okay.
Ma'am, maybe if you have to open up your screen a little bit. So, if you do a full screen of this itself.
1 minute.
Then it might pop up.
No, I have already done a full screen, but I'm not able to go back.
Can you see the chat? Can you see the chat and the participants and all down?
No. One minute. I need to log out of my PPT.
Yes.
Ma'am, you can mail it also and we can share it from here if you want.
Yeah, but there's some problem with the computer. I don't know why.
Would you like to minimize the screen and see what happens? Not minimize, but...
I have to minimize the screen. I'm not able to do it. 1 minute.
Escape, ma'am?
Yes. Control, command, escape. No. Can I just... 1 minute.
Ma'am, as Richard, you were suggesting if you share it, then maybe Aditya or somebody can also put it up from their end.
Okay. Yeah, I'm here. Now, I have the screen there. Zoom interrupted, restart. Should I just say share the screen now?
Yes.
Desktop one. I just say share. Now, Zoom two, open system preferences. No.
Maybe you'd like to forward the presentation to Richa ma'am then.
Okay, then I'll have to go back. It will take me a while.
Okay, Archana ma'am, for your convenience, what you do, you keep the PPT open on your desktop, okay?
It's open on my desktop.
So now when you click on the share screen option, a big window will open, okay? And inside that you will see a lot of items. So just click on your PPT.
So this is my PPT is there.
Yeah. Now you do it with me. You go to share screen. Click on that, please.
1 minute. I have to now escape it again.
No problem. Okay.
No. So,
now are you with me, ma'am?
No, I'm not. I'm not able to switch off the PPT.
Okay, ma'am. Let's use the most convenient option then. You mail it to Dr. Richa Chopra. I will pick it up from there and I will stand present on your behalf. You can watch this
slide and
talk through them. Yeah.
Yeah.
Alternatively, ma'am, would you like to try to end task and close the PPT?
Yeah, I have 1 minute. I close the PPT.
Because that will allow you access to your mail and you can send it out first.
Yeah. See my, I'll just log out and then log in again. Yeah.
From Zoom, ma'am?
Yeah. Oh, 1 minute. Let me see if I can still, no.
If you reduce the screen, you can maybe go to your Gmail and send it to Richa, ma'am.
Yeah.
Oh, wonderful. Start. No. Shalini sharing.
Yeah, I just wanted to show a demonstration, ma'am. Okay. So.
No. No. Yeah, okay.
Have you been able to access your Gmail, ma'am?
Yeah, I've been able to access my Gmail. My problem is that my, you see, Mac was hacked before I came by the Cambodians.
So, they managed to hack a Mac, that's not bad.
Okay. Yeah. So 1 minute. I think I'll have to log off and then do it all over again. 1 minute. Huh?
Sure.
So, ma'am, one request. When you log off, please send a mail to Dr. Richa Chopra with your attachment and then we'll keep
it.
I
will do it, yeah.
Thank you.
So, it is going to come by Google Drive.
Okay.
I think the attachment is heavy, ma'am. So it'll attach as a Google.
It's coming.
You could send
it.
It's Chopra at Shrishi University.
Yeah. Okay, here we go. Okay, it's been sent.
Yes, ma'am, it is yet to be received.
Okay. So I log off from the Gmail.
Ha, ma'am, it has yet, ma'am, it's come. So,
okay. Yeah. It's a heavy file. Okay. Yeah.
Dr. Vidya Bhatia, are you there?
Yeah.
Dr. Vidya Bhatia, are you there?
Yes, ma'am, she's there. I think, Aditi, you have to make her the co-host, Vidya Bhatia, ma'am.
And I would request Dr. Vidya to please present. She can download it. Archana, Dr. Anuradha,
yeah.
I'm marking it to you also. Huh?
All right.
Yeah, I was just saying, unmute me. Okay.
Raja, ma'am, Vidya, ma'am is co-host now.
No, it says people without access won't be able to open the file, ma'am.
Actually, I think it's with you, Richaji.
So, can the access...
Can I go back?
Yes, ma'am, I think you would have to give us access. So, you'd have to put all the email addresses there. Only then that access would be given to the others.
Okay, so I go back.
Richaji, can you put it up from your place?
No, she will also have to give the access, I guess.
No, she would have, okay.
1 minute, I go back to it.
And can you give the file an open access so that...
Yes, I'll do that. I will do that.
No, it's for me also, it says you don't have access to this page.
Really?
Hmm. Yeah, ma'am. That's why it hasn't come to me yet.
Ma'am, the slides are ready with me. I'll present.
Right.
Tell me, you have it with you?
So
yeah, I have downloaded them. So I'm just going to, just it's opening.
Just tell me to whom do I send it? And now
send it again. You need not send it again. It's ready in on my desktop. I'll start to share it. You can stay on the Zoom link, ma'am. And okay. I will just give me 1 minute.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
If Shalini also forward me the same.
Okay. Ma'am, Vidya ma'am, it will take a lot of time. So just in